Good morning, good morning, good morning, everybody. This is Jeremiah's JMan Monero. JMan Speaks. Welcome to A-Team Friday. That's Ask the Experts. Anything Meaningful Friday. Great to see you. We're going to hit you with the DJ air horn right off the bat. That's right. We're happy that you made it. Today's, we're going to give you five ways to thrive in this market. Thrive, because I don't believe that you should just be surviving, right? When people say, I will survive. We had a lip sync competition yesterday for an event, and that was one of the ones they did. We will survive. While there are some agents who put their head in the sand in March of 2020 and said, I just need to survive this few weeks, this month, this 3 months, this 6 months. Some of us said, yo, man, it's my time to thrive. And I appreciate you if you're watching this live or you're watching it on the playback. We got a good morning to Billy Parrott over in Billings, Montana. Billy and B-Town, hashtag Billy and B-Town in the house. Thanks for being here. Man, what an exciting week we've had so far. And again, put in the comments where you're from and just give me one thing that you feel you could learn about today from an expert that might make your business better. I do have some content prepared for you. But again, man, you got access to somebody that can give you some insight to change your business for the better. Why not ask the questions? And if you're watching this on the playback, you could also just put it in the comments. I monitor this frequently and I will answer those questions. Or it also gives me content creation ideas, because if you ask a question this week, then next week I might do a 30-minute broadcast on it. Okay? Let's see what we got. Oh, we got Dr. Jeffrey Scott Stanton from the NYC's in the house. Bah, bah, bah. We got Sharon M. Virgin from the Great Falls of Montana. Great place. Although, Sharon, is there falls there? I don't think I saw falls. I think I saw like the cool spring water thing. Maybe I'm wrong. I don't know. It's a good name. Good name. All right. So again, what's one thing you feel like you could do better? I know in the last 2 weeks, if you haven't heard, Clubhouse has launched for Android. Those of us Android users who have been very excited, all of my speaker friends have been like, you got to get on Android. You got to get on Android. Or you got to get on Clubhouse. Got to get on Clubhouse. And I'm like, I actually went to Best Buy 2 times to get an iPhone. Bless my heart. To get an iPhone just to get Clubhouse. But the salespeople were taking too long. And I was like, yo, I'm out. I can't. This is a sign I should stick with Android. And so we have it. It's still not fully capable as the iPhone app is, but it's really great. If you're not on there, Jeffrey, I want to do the I've been doing a 5 a.m. win the wake up. I know you're an early bird just like me. Hit me up. That's what I was saying about a 5 a.m. club on CH. CH is like Clubhouse. Like FB is Facebook. Like IG is Instagram. You got it now. Okay. We got Billy hooked in there. Billy is loving Clubhouse. She did her first hosting of an event. She was a moderator of a YPN event. So if you are a YPNer, want to get more involved, or just want to have a discussion with some industry leaders, I think she's going to be doing that once a month. And I found like in one day I could be talking to somebody from the UK, somebody from Atlanta, somebody from New York, somebody from Cali. Like really the international national reach with that is unbelievable, because you do talk to people on like a more personal level than, you know, like I'm doing a live stream now. You guys are commenting, but I'm not hearing your voices. I'm not seeing the inflection. You can't really contribute as much to the conversation. As you can on Clubhouse. But let's see. What's one thing? Let's see. I'm going to wait here in the comments. Today's casual Friday. So I got my shorts on. Got my shorts on and my chucks. Yep. Mm-hmm. All right. I'll wait for you guys. I'm going to come over here to my presentation and do this real fast. All right. Five ways to thrive in this market. We did this for Massachusetts not too long ago. This is a shorter 25. Like I have a 3-hour CE class for this, okay? So I'm just going to give you some nuggets, and then off the nuggets, when you have questions, we're going to stop. And I'm like, yo, this is what it's all about. Okay, first of all, first things first, our papa brings all the money. that might be a parody right there. Be on the lookout for our newest parody coming soon. OPP, other people's property. We'll give you five ways that you can thrive during our current market conditions. Number one is to get virtual. Okay, get virtual, everybody. Tips for stronger offers, especially when your buyer is the FHA. Okay, good. I'm going to talk about that. Bring that comment up here. Tips for stronger offers, especially when your buyer is FHA. Well, that gets started with number one, get virtual, the virtual consult, okay? And what I mean by the virtual consult is that my remote is dead. That's what I mean. Now, right, when you were referred to a buyer, you would meet with them and you'd say, oh, come into the office. And now our very first meetings for whether it's a buyer or it's a seller happens via Zoom, right? You close right to that Zoom appointment. That's why it makes sense. You need to be better at being virtual. It's time. It's 14 months, 15 months into the pandemic. If you're not a virtual expert, what in the hell are you doing? Okay? That's all I got to say about that, man. That's all I got to say, right? If you haven't seen this here, I'll give you another. Do I have the behind the scenes hooked up here? Now I'll show you guys later, but you've seen it before. So the virtual consult, you need to download the Zoom app on your phone as well as the desktop client. You shouldn't be using it during, you know, in your browser. There are free downloads for both, but I'm going to recommend that you go pro. Going pro is $15 a month, $150 a year. The two supplements that you can also use are Google Duo and Facebook Messenger. I talk to my clients. I talk to people. I probably have 10 to 12 Facebook Messenger conversations a day. And if my cousin Victor's watching in Costa Rica, right, internationally you can use Facebook Messenger, but you could also use WhatsApp. So if you have international clientele, if you're in a major metro market where you have that, WhatsApp is pretty awesome too, okay? So here, I'm not going to give you all the Zoom tips and tricks. What you want to do is send me a message on my Facebook page. You're on it now. If you're watching this, you send one message, Zoom tips. It's going to auto-reply, okay? Auto-reply with 16 pages of my recommended Zoom settings. It's 16 pages because I have screenshots, and then I have rationale of why you should have these as your settings, okay? Things like making sure that you have the waiting room enabled. Yesterday, I did an event and I sent them the settings, but they didn't go all the way through. Making sure you can have a host and a co-host, making sure you can share documents in the chat. There's a lot of little minute details that make all the difference if you're going to really start using this at a high level. Okay, so just send me Zoom tips, or you can go to zoomtips.jmanseminars.com and that'll forward you to the same spot, my Facebook Messenger bot. It'll auto reply with the resources. Okay, dress for success. Unlike this guy right here, I would never I would never wear this for a virtual appointment. I'm wearing it for you guys because you're my people. But for a client, I actually have a change of clothes in here. I always have a pair of slacks and a branded polo shirt. That's usually my daily attire for real estate. Okay, you don't have to wear shirt and tie. I mean, even if you're doing the virtual mullet, we call it, right? You got business up top and party on the bottom, whether you're not wearing pants, you're wearing pajamas, you're wearing leggings, whatever the case may be. That's awesome. Yeah. And good point from Jeffrey. Let me bring it up here for, if you have a corporate account, you can request HD video from Zoom. So I have an enterprise level account as well. And all of my video, the recordings, is 1080p, right? Because if you follow me, you're going to be doing video, and you want that stuff to be as high, the highest resolution possible, okay? True HD, baby. That's what I'm talking about. Because some of these platforms, if you try to download this video after the fact, it's not going to be 1080p. Facebook will degrade your resolution every time. Virtual backgrounds. You see, I am a virtual background master. I get all of my video backgrounds from videoblocks.com. You don't have to be as fancy as me. You can go to canva.com, create your own virtual backgrounds. Just do virtual backgrounds or Zoom virtual backgrounds. They'll have the template there for you. And keep in mind, you don't have to use the backgrounds they have. Search the photos. Go to Pixabay, P-I-X-A-B-A-Y. Go to Pixabay and find a background that you like, right? And then use that. Make it, you know, make sure you add your branding if it's going to be an office-related thing, if you're going to be meeting with clients. The worst possible thing that you could do is to meet with the client at your house, in your kitchen, or somewhere in your house, right? And your freaking background's a mess, right? Because if I'm meeting with you and I can see your background number, well, I got ADHD, right? But it's probably worse for me. But the average person is still going, oh, damn, that's messy. Look at this kitchen. It's disorganized. And in their mind, they're going to go, disorganized kitchen. That's how I would say disorganized life. That's the transaction's going to be disorganized. So you don't have to clean up. Well, you could. You could virtually stage it. If you had just a 4x4 area is what I always say, like a corner. Facing a corner is always easy. You could put up a green screen there. Just keep it nice, neat, tidy, and organized. Stage that background so that's going to be your broadcasting area. That's where you're going to meet with clients. Make sure that it's quiet. Make sure that you're not going to be interrupted by kids. Make sure you have a lock on the door. And by quiet, I mean like the landscapers and stuff like that. They're always going to come at a time when you have an important meeting. I promise you, right? If you're doing it from home, they're going to come and you're all that noise. And you're like, I guess that helps to have a noise-canceling microphone as well. Lighting is important. Let me show you the lighting sitch here. So if I went like this, see the difference? No light, light, no light, light. All right. Lighting can make all the difference. If you've ever purchased something at the store, you were like, damn, girl, I look good. And then you got home and you're like, oh, dang, I do not look as good as I did in the store. It's because of the lighting. The lighting's designed for you to look good in the store and buy it and go home. In your settings, though, you can also look prettier. This is probably my favorite image. Do I look pretty? They've actually changed it. See where it's maybe a little blurry for you, but it says touch up my appearance. Instead of a checkbox there, they actually have a sliding scale. So you can go from what you look like to like Benjamin Button, like meow, wah, and be like, no wrinkles, just smooth it all out. Okay? Some of you, look it, I wore this shirt for you. It's how you look, okay? So who the hell cares? Just get on the video. They're going to see you anyways in person without a filter. So you might as well warn them ahead of time. All right? But they also now have a setting in there to adjust for low light conditions. You should never look like this photo right there during your Zoom. Virtual offer presentations. So we actually, and we've showed this in other videos. I don't know if I want to right now. Maybe I will. We use BombBomb, if I can get it up fast enough. And right, if you have 13, 14, 20, 30 offers, but only one email comes in with a video from the agent saying, hey, this is Jeremiah, it's JMan Monero with the Monero team at XYZ Realty. I just wanted to let you know. I wanted to go over the kind of the terms and conditions of the offer. I promise you this is not a love letter. So could you please play it for the seller? Now, I am going to bring it up for you guys so that you can see it. Because seeing is believing. Does it really? Jeffrey says, touch up your appearance helps with a wrinkled shirt. It might be true, but no, I don't think it could be true. It might be true. Okay, I'm going to show you this, I guess. It is? Stop. I'm going to test your theory later. I'm going to get a wrinkled shirt when I get home. And I'm going to test that out. That's freaking awesome. So you don't even have to. One of the reasons why people ask me, they're like, you know, why do you wear, like, you know, why don't you just wear a dress shirt? Why do you wear a dress shirt with a suit jacket? And I don't even wear the dress shirt anymore. I just wear t-shirts. But when I was wearing the dress shirt, and I'd be like, well, because if I just wore a dress shirt, I'd have to iron the whole thing. All of it, the arms, the back. When I used to wear a suit with a dress shirt, I just iron the front, man. Be done. Be done with it. It's perfect. All right, let me show you this. I can't believe all these secrets I share with you guys. So here is an actual offer that was sent. And in here, in the cover letter, if you will, it says, we kindly ask you play the above video or for the email. Here, let me zoom this a little for you so you can see a little better. We kindly ask that you play the above video or forward the email for the seller. It has very important details in regards to our offer. It is not a love letter because depending on what state you're in, we know in New York State it's frowned upon because it gives the opportunity for the seller to discriminate on any of the protected classes. So the buyer is pre-approved the conventional financing through ESL with sue downs. pre-approved, not pre-qualified, right? And I put in there, they have submitted docs and verified anything. We just, or everything. We just needed to identify the home and have an appraisal done. Okay. So much better. She's pre-committed. That's what that means. In addition, we want to do an inspection, but it is not a contingency. Check with local home inspectors in your area. They can do what are called mini inspections. Okay, or you just don't make it a contingency. Say it's for her information only. Anything that gets found out, then you know she knows what to budget for. But a mini inspection means the home inspector can come with you and the buyer during the showing for 30 minutes, right? And during that 30 minutes, check out the most important things and then give, they're not going to write up a report. It's more like a verbal evaluation of the property. Still better than waiving everything, not having a second set of eyes. Because if something happens, this is what you guys got to think about in this market. If something happens, they're coming to you. Okay? Even though you go, well, do you want to waive the inspection? It's all on how you ask. I think you should waive the inspection. Then they're going to go, well, you wanted me to waive the inspection. This is all your fault. I have a structural issue. It costs $50,000. I'm suing you. I'm suing the seller. I'm suing the seller's agent. Everybody's getting sued. You're getting sued, and you're getting sued, and you're getting sued. So make sure you try to defer as much liability as you can by doing an inspection, if at all possible. We have Austin in here. We'll try to close as soon as possible, but our closing date is flexible. She is employed, right? Employment is not a protected class. So if your client has a very good job that they have little or no chance of getting fired from, like this one, she's employed at a director level position at the University of Rochester with a slim to no chance of being laid off or furloughed. Okay, solid buyer. We've looked at dozens of homes. This is the first one that she loved enough to call it home. She loves everything about it, can see herself living and making memories here for a very long time. Again, nothing wrong with that statement there. I thank you in advance for presenting the offer and giving us the opportunity to compete for this home. Now, pretty much that's what I say in the video.
Hi, Fallon. This is Jeremiah. It's JMan Monero, the Monero team at RE/MAX Realty Group. First of all, thank you for allowing us to submit this offer. But I just want to explain some of the important details of our offer, starting with our pre-approval. My client is...
Okay, everything I just said in there, I say in the video, but then I also at the end say, you know, and I've worked with Fallon in the past. I'm very well qualified. I've been in the business for 16 years. I have all these designations. I'm not saying that to impress you, but to impress upon you the fact that on the other end, this is teamwork to get to closing. On the other end, you know that you have a team member that will get it done. Thank you very much. Right? And done. Setting yourself apart from the competition. Okay, if that wasn't a good enough nugget for today, I don't know what else you guys are looking for. All right, coming back to the virtual offer presentation. Boom, 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 boom. Virtual buyer-seller presentations as well. So you can meet with a buyer or a seller, like I said, virtually. That initial meeting, oh, I get referred to a buyer. I'm going to meet with them via Zoom. Okay, instead of saying, do you do Zoom? I go, okay, our first meetings are going to happen via Zoom or whatever other platform you're familiar with. I could do tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock or tomorrow afternoon around 4 if that's better for you. You give them, you know, and most people today in this day and age have been on Zoom. So they should be okay. All right. Same thing with a listing presentation. Not necessarily, you know, maybe the initial consultation. Hey, yeah, you know, nice to meet you. Look forward to talking to you about selling your home. Why don't you just give me a quick walk around like I'm a potential buyer? And then you have the seller walk around the home if they're on their iPhone or if they're on their iPad or something like that. It's a great way to build rapport, see the home, get familiar with it, do a better CMA and without leaving your office, right? I can do all these appointments back to back to back without any travel time. Some of you live in areas that have traffic. Some of you, like my Montana folks, you don't necessarily have traffic. It's just you travel great distances between appointments. Might be 30 minutes, an hour, 2 hours between your appointments. Like you could do all that from your office. Okay, Facebook Messenger. I already said this, but download the app. Okay, don't be bent out of shape if somebody contacts you via Facebook. There is 1.6 billion people on Messenger. There's 2.4 billion people on Facebook. Okay, there's more than half the people in the world on Facebook or on the internet. Half the people on the internet are on Facebook. It's a really important statistic. But over 2.2
billion. There's something new in Messenger. Introducing group video chat.
Funny, as I did that, somebody messengered me. But Google Duo as well. It's mobile only, but it's cross-platform. I like that because you iPhone users love to use FaceTime, but us Android people do not have FaceTime, okay? Google Duo is cross-platform. You can have up to 12 people on there at once. You could also send video message via Google Duo. You could also send text messages via Duo. And it also has a cool feature called Knock Knock, where they can see you before they pick up the actual call. So if you want people to pick up, you're like, or I might take something, write it on a piece of paper, or my brother will tell me, like, you're number one, you're number one, you're number one. Not with his thumb, obviously, to get me to pick up the phone, but use it to your advantage. Google Duo is great. Okay, number two, educate the client. What I mean by educate them on everything that has to do with the real estate transaction. During that virtual consult that I talked about, you want to lock down an exclusive right to represent or a buyer's agency agreement in this market more than any other market. It is so critical because they're going to blame you for any failures. Because if you don't explain, give them a realistic expectation of what might happen, like you're going to write a dozen offers in this market. Okay. You're likely going to have to go 10 to 20% over the list price. The list price is a starting price in most cities in situations, okay? So you have to prepare them for the worst case scenario, because if you go, oh yeah, there's still some deals out there. I got somebody their first offer accepted the other day. You didn't say it was a cash offer and then nobody else wanted this dump that they wrote an offer on. You didn't say all that, right? So you need to like bring these realistic expectations, and then at the end say, I will only commit. I have the highest level of service. I am an expert buyer's agent, okay? I will scour to the ends of the earth to find you the property that you're looking for, but you have to commit to me, right? Because I will be calling expireds. I will be going after for sale by owners. I will be doing everything I can. I'll be networking in my office. Who has listings coming up? All of that to find you the home of your dreams. I will only deliver that level of service to somebody that's committed to me, okay? And I don't care where you're from. I can get these signed every single city in the world. Okay. You would never list the house without an exclusive right to sell. Why would you list the buyer? Because what's going to happen is all of a sudden they're going to ghost you. You write one offer, two offers, three offers. Jeffrey says the list price is the invitation to the party. I like that. But if you, what will happen in this market is you write a few offers, like you are a motivational speaker to your clients in every transaction, right? After, it wasn't meant to be. It's all right. You didn't want to pay too much for the property anyways. It's a numbers game. Like I said, there's going to be a dozen. And you got to keep them up. And just say, look at all of this. The journey is just important as the destination, right? Get them there. So that one day when we're at your housewarming party, we're going to be talking about all of these offers we wrote. And then you're going to be so happy that you didn't get those houses or those offers accepted because you found the home of your dreams, right? That's the conversation you have to have. Exclusive right to represent. And then you also want to bring up there's the top two ways they're going to cheat on you is new construction and for sale by owner. So bring that up. Bring up the scenarios like, hey, for sale by owner, if you see somebody who's selling their house on themselves, it's perfect. It's like a real estate agent who had no training, who doesn't know how to negotiate. Send them my way. I will get you the best deal possible. And I'm not going to try to list that house. I'm going to sell it to my buyer and negotiate on their behalf, period, right? And then new construction, I would tell them like, new construction is the only transaction besides multiple offers these days where you come in at a certain price point. Let's say you come in at $400,000. You could quite easily leave that appointment and you're in for five, okay? Because you're like, oh, honey, yes. Oh, no, we have to do the 9-foot ceilings. Oh, no, and we have to upgrade the cabinets. Oh, and the granite instead of the formica, absolutely. And the imported Italian, next thing you know, it goes up and up and up. So it makes sure a buyer's agent pays for themselves tenfold when it comes to the new construction transaction, okay? So get that done. Get the exclusive rights represent. Bring that back over here. Boom, educate them on market realities. What does that mean? Especially those of you who are in a non-disclosure state like Montana, you're watching this. They don't have access to the data. It's up to you to explain how is the market, right? You see this? How's the market? The market is on fire, okay? You give them the statistics. Like, look at average sale price in the city of Rochester the last 5 years is up 54.7%. What? Yeah, 54.7%. So when your dad comes to the to the showing and goes, "This house isn't worth that." I'm like, "Dad, when was the last time you looked at houses? 1986, right? That's when my dad bought his last house." Like, you don't know the market. So you got to educate them. And the best way to do that, we use RPR. I get if you're in a non-disclosure state or you're not a realtor member, that may not be as good, but Cloud CMA is a good option. Your MLS should have statistics that you can share with them as well. Whatever it is, get it done. Okay, number three, get creative. And that's where we're strategizing. Billy, you had said something about working with an FHA buyer, right? So you have an FHA buyer. This is part of that virtual consult. Like, okay, so you have FHA, 3.5% down. Do you need concessions? If you need concessions, we need to wait. You need to save more money, or we need to see if you have a relative that can gift you the money. We need to see if you have a retirement plan or something. Sometimes you can borrow against a 401k without penalty. That's where, like, strategize. All of that has to happen before you write the offer. You shouldn't be like, "We got to get this house," and now you're trying to put together a strategy to get that offer accepted, right? I had one guy who was referred to me after he had multiple unsuccessful attempts with another agent. And he says, "This is what I got. I got FHA, you know, how high should we go?" I go, "Well, you got any rich relatives?" He's like, "What do you mean?" I'm like, "Do you know anybody with enough money so that you can buy this house cash?" He's like, "Yeah." I'm like, "Well, you need to have a conversation, whatever, you know, blood oath to them or whatever you need to do, put it in writing, notarize it." He ended up getting cash money from a friend of his, not even a relative. I'm like, "You should kiss this guy's feet." Okay. Ended up getting cash money from a friend. So then when he closed, he would do a cash out refinance. So maybe see if there's hard money lenders in your area. Maybe see if there's, and what I mean by hard money is these are the guys that would loan money, or gals, I don't want to say guys, people. These are the organizations that would loan money when somebody couldn't get a mortgage, right? So it could be, maybe you have some down payment. A lot of these guys, just for an average rate, it might be cost you 2 points, so 2% of the loan, and the interest rate might be 12%. But who cares, because you're only going to hold that for 3 months, 6 months tops. So the difference of what you would pay in cash, number one, you would get the property. Number two, you're probably going to pay less money. Okay, and then cash it out, refinance, and get that done. So I mean, I don't say FHA would be impossible. You know, if you have somebody who's an FHA buyer, then it's like, maybe I might look at, maybe set up a search for properties that have been on the market for more than 10 days. Okay, you can do days on market so that you can get notified when something hits the 10th day. Because if it hasn't sold in 10 days in this market, in most markets, it might be around. You might be able to get a deal. Right? So just you wait out those ones that get multiple offers right in the beginning, and you get notified of the croutons or the stale bread. Three things to always consider: price, terms, and conditions, right? If your price is as high as it can get, we know people that are getting creative with, like, not reimbursing the taxes of the seller, paying back the seller the taxes. Or I had an offer, heard of an offer getting accepted just west of us. They gave them season tickets to the Buffalo Bills. I take the offer, shoot, right? Do you have season tickets? And like, I don't care about the extra $5,000, $10,000, take the deal. Okay. We had to have a discussion with the seller the other day. How much did it make a difference between financing and cash? Meaning, let's say we had an offer for $295, we countered the financing offer because they had a higher cap on that escalation clause for $305. It was ten. They said for $10,000, we're willing to risk, you know, a mortgage. Cash is cash, right? But for $10,000, we're willing to whisk it. We're gonna whisk it, Barbara Walters. We're gonna whisk it with an egg beater. We're willing to risk it. You got to have that conversation, right? You can't be like, "Oh, cash, done deal. And then when you talk about appraisals, guaranteeing that if there's a shortage in the appraisal, making sure you have that discussion on the buy side. I have in here volunteering, because I believe you should be volunteering, but also the more you volunteer, get involved with your committees and your task forces and go to events and go to virtual events. This should also be networking. The more you meet people, the more likely you are to get deals done. right? Because if I'm in Jeff Stanton's market, and we're friends, and we have multiple offers, and it mine's very competitive, all the things being the same, the person he has the rapport with and who's he's confident that's going to take it through to closing is who he's going to select, right? Escalation number four is get aggressive. We talked about escalation clauses in the past. Again, there's so many different rules of how to use this. I come from a no cap perspective, no cap. And I'm not talking to the kids these days say no cap, which means they're not lying. But no cap means no cap on that escalation clause. So you can get the call with whatever that number might be. And I understand that some of you aren't in markets where you don't write your own contracts, you're written offer to purchase, and then it has to go to the attorney to mess up. And that can be challenging. Okay? But get aggressive. And what I mean by get aggressive, don't be that guy over there on the right there. Don't bully people. Either side, whether you're a seller's agent or a buyer's agent, you catch more bees with honey, baby, right? You know, it's like you call them up like, hey, you know, having that conversation when you show the property. Oh, you know, Jeremiah, I showed the house, really great house. The buyer is really interested. If you could just keep us in the loop if any offers come in. Okay, some of you under the misconception, like we have to contact you if an offer comes in. It might be customary in the market, but there is no law that says we have to contact you. Okay, if we're asked, if there's other offers, it's a different story. So making sure, hey, keep us in the loop. Don't be this guy on the right going, what do you mean you didn't tell me about the other offer? My clients were interested. Dude, stay in touch if you're interested, right? And then when you send the offer, you send your video offer, call them, or, you know, hey, we're going to be writing an offer. Jane, I just wondered, what matters most to the seller? Is it the time frame? Is it money? You know, what would make them like super happy and get our offer accepted? Ask the question. Without asking the questions, you don't get the answers. Buyer beware. Buyer beware. Caveat emptor, right? That means you're a deep doo-doo if you buy a property because you had a reasonable time to inspect it and do your due diligence as a buyer. So inspection options. You have a waiver of liability as an option. Mini inspection, what I talked about. You can do an inspection but not a contingency. If you've ever sold a HUD home, you could always do an inspection on HUD homes. Always. They allowed you to. They just, you know, they said if you sent them the inspection within 2 weeks with a major defect, they might do something about it. And if not, they'll allow you to cancel. If you're in an attorney approval state, you know, you could have do your inspection, not a contingency, but still have the attorney disapprove the contract. They don't need to give a reason why they're disapproving. Creative. Use that big brain. Okay. Do an inspection. Have a price limit on repairs. Like, hey, we want to do an inspection, but we won't ask for anything more than $5,000. So even if my offer is $50,000 more than the highest price, you know, I've gotten home inspections accepted with a high price tag, like over asking, and been like, well, I mean, it's a nice property, right? I don't see any issues. Do you, listing agent? And they're like, well, no, I don't either. Right? So I'm getting them on my side. Like there shouldn't be any problems. Do that. Okay. Keep standing appointment with an inspector. I heard that on Clubhouse last week. I thought it was a great idea. Like if you have an inspector you work with so that if I write an offer on a Tuesday, I can get that home inspected on a Wednesday. And if it is a contingency or whatever, we can get that done and out of the way rather quickly. And then the last one is did seller have a pre-listing inspection? Meaning before they put the property on the market. Again, if you're working with the seller, maybe you want to do that because great idea, right? Here's the inspection. These are some things that came up, but we fixed them. It would help people be more confident in making an offer on the home. Sharon says, good morning. Did you guys get snow? Oh, are these Montana people talking back and forth? Because we didn't get snow here in New York. In New York, we are 80 something degrees. I don't know how Jeff is downstate, but that's how life is in the rock. Finding sellers for sale. I love that image, like the shopper's shopping cart. Yeah, you do too. So big data is the future of everything. Okay. You got apps like Remine. Remine analyzes the data and the public information to give sell scores, high sell scores, which means people are more likely to sell. Cybor, I did an event for them yesterday. They use geodata. That has a sell score in there too, just like Realist, I believe. HomeSnap Pro will also tell you people who are likely to sell based on a number of things that they're tracking, analytics. Realist, looking for listings with Realist and GeoData. Actually, what you can do is look for people who are non-owner occupied, which means the billing address for the taxes is different than the property address. That tells me who's an absentee landlord. Absentee landlords right now, depending on where you are, could be going through a tough time because they have tenants that aren't paying and they can't evict them. Okay, so that's how, I mean, I have 15, 20, I got a seller calling right now, 15, 20 transactions this year alone from investors who wanted to cash out on their investment properties. Okay, first.io, there's a certain franchise that has that, but Revaluate is their competition. What they do is you import your sphere of influence into it. It analyzes each person based on certain data points that they're tracking, and they give you a sell score on who to keep in touch with. So you have your entire database. They'll say, oh man, you should contact JMan. He's got an 89 out of 100 potential sell score. And they track it. And if you don't, I had first.io and I was like, whatever, that guy's not selling. 2 weeks later, the freaking thing is on the market. I'm like, all right. Cause then it tracks like how much money you've lost from people that are in your database. And it could be just people that are in your phone. That's a lot of times how you can do it with some of these. You just take your phone, you import all of your contacts in your phone because there's people you haven't talked to in a while who may be selling. SmartZip, that's direct mail, can still be a viable option when you can't door knock and you can't do certain cold calling. SmartZip will focus on zip codes or market service areas. But again, predictive analytics, it says it will only send it to the people who are more likely to sell. Okay, and then JMan's Lister Predictor. That's a service we're going to be offering in the next 30 days. It's powered by Revaluate. You'll get a better price through us once we do that. And our bonus, number 6, old expired listings. Okay? Old expired listings. And what I mean by old, you can go back as long as your MLS goes back, right? All the way until like 2019 maybe. Maybe even 2020, maybe even last year. And then what I would do is scrub those. Our MLS and most MLSs have a history button. And so you then go through the history and see if that property was relisted and sold since it expired, because you don't want those. You want the ones that were on the market 2016, 2017, because like I said, our market, 54.7% increase in the average sale price over the last 5 years. So that house that didn't sell for 200 is now worth 300. So that's an easy conversation to have. Now, I saw your house was home on the, your home was on the market, should have sold but didn't, Mr. or Mrs. Potential Seller. Did you know our market is appreciated 54.7%? Okay, not only do we have a 10-point marketing strategy to get your home sold or we'll buy it, we have a social media marketing campaign, video marketing campaign, all that, and then some. But your property is now worth roughly $300,000. So you wouldn't want to leave any money on the table, would you? Of course not. Well, if you have a moment, I'd love to show you how the Monero team at XYZ Realty can help you realize the American dream of making your move. Okay, great. So in closing, what I'm going to say is, like, you got to learn how to play the game, right? Like chess, you don't, like those of you who know how to play chess, and that's why I use this image, it's like you know what the pieces do, but you play the player as much as you play the game. And so while every transaction is different, every agent's going to be different. And so what I'm doing is giving you tools depending on the situation so that you can excel. Okay? Victor Rivera, that's my cousin in Costa Rica. If you guys want to go to Costa Rica, make sure you hit up my cousin, Victor Rivera. He says, are most of these domestic products? No, I believe they're international. They may not be internationally known, but I'm known to rock the microphone because I get stupid. I mean, outrageous. No, they're all internet-based, so I don't see why they wouldn't. It all depends on how their database. So it all depends on how they publicly record sales of real estate in your area. Okay? So I'm going to bring it back over here to the main screen. Where are we at? Where are we at? Where are we at, everybody? All right, so that was 45 minutes of nuggets. Nugget. What else you need? You got any other questions? Just put them in the chat. Oh, see, Victor, I'm connecting you. Leticia's in, are you in Atlanta or Chicago? I know it's one of the two. She's in Chicago. So Costa Rica, we're actually going to be interviewing a Costa Rican real estate agent pretty soon that Victor's connected us with. So we can be your conduit for real estate referrals into Costa Rica. Victor, maybe you want to put in the comments a link to your bed and breakfast or VRBO. I'm not exactly sure. You're in Chicago. So you could fly there easy. So that's it. Any other questions, put them in the chat. If not, we're going to hit you out with the A-Team theme. Let's see. That's all I can do. Because